Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of May 5th, 2016. I'm City Council President Bill Dwight, and I will be presiding tonight. We will start, as per our custom, with public comment before we convene. The conditions of public comment are we ask you to keep your remarks to 2 minutes or under. When you come up, please state your name and address. And also be aware that the council, part of the council rules is that we are constrained from speaking. This is your turn to speak, not ours. We speak afterwards. But if any questions that you pose to the council have to remain unanswered until possibly after the meeting or any other time that you're able to contact the council. And starting off, we have Tony Patillo.
I'm here to Anthony Patillo, Florence Autumn Drive. I'm here because I've got some concerns about the process that we just went through for the election of the DPW director. On May 3rd, Mayor announced who the final candidate was. Shortly that day, I contacted my counselor and also sent an email to the mayor's office requesting to find out the names of the other finalists that were involved. I was later told that that information would not be forthcoming, and I received an email that in part says the mayor is the appointing authority, and the process just concluded there were no finalists. I also found that there were 30 applicants that had applied. Of those 30 applicants, the list ad hoc committee was formed. It was whittled down to 13. Those 13 were interviewed over a period of time. And on May 29th, it was disbanded. They put forward four names. And again, the email says these were not finalists. I don't know what you call it when you whittle down 30 to four, but they're not finalists. This process, I've been on several screening committees, and it's always been an issue of security with the applicants. When they apply, definitely there's a security issue, don't want people to know. But when you get down to the three or five names, which the mayor would request, then those names would become public. The public would have an opportunity to see who had applied for these positions and hopefully be able to weigh in. This wasn't done. And, you know, we've got a position that the director controls of DPW controls our water system, our roads, our stormwater management. This controls the staff of one of the largest staffing in the city's departments. And it seems that a golden opportunity was missed in giving an opportunity for the public to see what the net had cast in for the finalists for this position. And open and transparency were key issues, I thought, that this administration and this council were for. And apparently we will not find out the names of these non-finalists, but it really lends to people wanting to know why not. And it's been standard operating procedure for the years that I was involved in city government, that on key prominent positions that affect a large part of our population, that the finals are known to the public. And this wasn't done. And I just think it's a real blow to open and transparency. And I don't know what can be done, but I can't even find out if the person who is named as the finalist, who is named as the job, the last four. So it just, I hope that something can be done about that. It's not open and transparent. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Patty Shaughnessy, please.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Pat Shaughnessy. I'm the director at Northampton Senior Services, 67 Conn Street. On April 20th, Northampton Senior Services held their annual volunteer recognition dinner. To honor and, of course, recognize all of our volunteers. April also was National Volunteer Month, so it was a great time to put something together to say thank you to all of the volunteers that work at the Senior Center. I'd also like to just say thanks to Councilor Marianne LaBarge, who attended our dinner, and she's also a volunteer who does a lot for us, and thank you for that. And she was very gracious to accept the check that is our sort of looked at, here's what the volunteer hours count for when you look at what the volunteer time is worth. And so you all viewed that check last council meeting. The senior center has 151 volunteers, which we think is exceptional, and they perform a wide range of volunteer services. And I'll just mention a few of what some of the volunteers do. They work at the reception desk, in the gift shop, coffee shop, providing medical transportation rides, doing data entry, counseling services, teaching classes such as photography, computer, writing, and art, work at special events, food services. And the volunteers that we honored were from the hours 2015. And a total of 11,886 hours were logged by our volunteers at this senior center. And this year, the two top volunteers logging the most hours are here with me tonight, and they're also on the list to speak. Mary Listowski, who logged 505 hours for 2015, and Jim Spencer, who logged 796 hours. And both Jim and Mary were awarded and recognized for their hours, receiving the Elaine Koski Hours of Service Award. And so Mary and Jim are on the list next, so they're going to come up and say a few things.
Thank you, Patty. And in that order, Mary, you are first.
Hi, folks. Mary Listowski, as most of you know, and I started volunteering with my husband when the new senior center opened back a few years ago. We had a lot of nice volunteers at that time, and I've been doing it ever since. And he passed away, and I've continued and got more involved, and I'm there quite a bit. They ask me if I keep my bed down there sometimes, but I really enjoy it and enjoy the people, and I hope I make a difference to people. Sometimes I feel that what I give is not enough from what I get from the people, but I really enjoy it and hope we can get more volunteers because it really is a great thing and I enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Spence. You're next.
Thank you. I'm Jim Spencer from Florence. Many of you know me. 800 and something hours, it just sort of added up. It just wasn't a big deal. My wife mentioned it was a big deal, but other than that, she's still with me, so it wasn't too bad. People ask me why I volunteer that much. I don't get paid for it. I just have a good time. But I will tell you that the volunteers provide a service to the people. I was started volunteering in this old building here, which is about, 11 years ago, something like that now?
We moved in 2007.
So, a while back. Been doing that since I've been volunteered. My people in my writing class have actually published 11 books. And if you're in the publishing business, that's pretty significant for us. And we have picked up, I think at last count, 22 photography prizes, two of which are nationally awarded. So, you know, that's what I get paid for when those people come up and say, gee, Jim, I got an award, you know, from the National Geographic. You know, this, and by the way, one of the women who is publishing her book is 94 years old, first one, not too shabby, you know. So that's what volunteering is for me, and I love it. I think everybody should do more. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That's all I have signed up for public comment. Anyone else want to speak? Okay. All right. Ask the administrative assistant to please call the roll.
Here.
Councilor Bidwell.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor Boyd.
Here.
Councilor
Klein. Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor
Schiff. Here.
All right. We're all present and accounted for, so we have a quorum, so we may convene. First off, we're going to start off with an announcement that there will be a public hearing pertaining to a petition received from National Grid regarding a permit to relocate a SO pole on Elm Street. And the public hearing will be held here during the City Council meeting of May 19th at 7:05 p.m. Now, are there any one-minute announcements?
I have one communication.
Okay, you come after the one-minute announcements on the agenda. All right, Councilor Bidwell.
Two of them, actually.
All right.
This Saturday from 9 to 1 at Smith Voke is the Northampton Education Foundation's plant sale. It's their 20th one of these. It's a wonderful event. Anybody who's a gardener should be there to get great stuff. And the proceeds all go to books for our public school. And secondly, next Tuesday, the 11th, in Springfield, the Springfield Regional Chamber is hosting a roundtable discussion. They're calling it Creating a Western Massachusetts Renaissance. It's about economic development opportunities in Western Mass. The panel will include Rick Sullivan, who is now the CEO of Western Mass Economic Development Council, and many of us knew him when he was mayor of Westfield, Paul Patrick's chief of staff, so it should be a pretty interesting presentation for those of us who want to put Northampton's economic development issues in a Western Mass context. I'm going. If anyone wants to share a ride, let me know.
Councilor Shara.
I'm going to announce this now in the hopes we've got more people paying attention than at the end of our agenda. The Committee on Community Resources is having a series of forums on the downtown economy. And the first one starts on May 16th, that's Monday, at 5:30 here in the chambers. That one is geared towards business owners, but anyone's welcome to come and join and participate in that. And then the other three are Monday, June 20th at 5:30, around downtown workers and residents. Monday, June 27th at 1 p.m. For downtown workers. These are all here in the chambers. And the last one is Property Owners, Leasing, Arts, and Tourism. And that is Monday, July 18th at 5:30 here. Anyone wants more information, on the city website under City Council, there's a subhead that's committee study requests. If you click on that, we have a page that has tons of information. It has the videos of the past meetings. It has all the documents and information that we've received thus far. And all sorts of other stuff. So feel free to go there or contact me.
Any other one-minute announcements? I will just do a pre-announcement that the council will be conducting budget hearings starting May 24th and 25th. What's that? 25th and 26th, I'm informed. I actually won't be present. I'm afraid I'll be in California celebrating my son's 30th birthday, which own punishment, and Councilor O'Donnell will be presiding. But what I'm asking for is the council to consider submitting to the administrative assistant your recommendations and requests for who you would like to hear from during the course of those budget hearings. Councilor LaBarre.
What was the date on that?
The 25th and 26th.
Thank you.
Do we have a time yet?
No times yet. We have to figure out who we got first and then figure out, try to allocate an appropriate time for them. So, communications from the mayor.
Yes. Good evening, councilors. I just wanted to make a quick announcement. At the past several meetings, I've been bringing orders forward to you regarding the city's LED streetlight project, and we've been trying to seek the community's input on the implementation of that project. Specifically, there have been installed several test lamp fixtures, including different bulb types, and we've set up a page on the website where people can go and actually fill out a survey, find those particular fixtures, take a look at them, and just give us some feedback on them. So I would direct people to the homepage of the website, and then there's an LED streetlights page that you can go to. It gives you information about what we're doing, and then also gives people information on where they can find these streetlights and take a look at them. So we're starting to get some feedback already, comments that we're getting in from people's reactions.
So what you're soliciting is actually not the Design of the feature.
Not the design of the fixture.
The temperature of the light, as it's known, from cool white, blue, to more yellow, warmer colors. So there's two options there to see which the community prefers.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. And again, there's a quick online survey that people can take. And we're trying to collect some feedback before we advance the project.
Thank you. Okay. All right. Now we come to resolutions. This is a resolution. This is item 16.077. This is a resolution to affirm the city's non-discrimination policy and in support of equality and access in public places. This is upon the recommendation of Councilor Ryan R. O'Donnell. And this, as I said, is to affirm the city's non-discrimination policy. And whereas the city of Northampton is guided by a fundamental and compelling interest to protect the civil rights of all its citizens and visitors and support public policies that prohibit unjust discrimination and promote a society characterized by freedom and equality. And whereas a free and equal society is one in which all people may access public places, including commercial space such as restaurants, hotels, theaters, as well as public space such as municipal buildings, parks, public transportation, among others, on equal terms. And whereas in 2011, the Massachusetts legislature extended protections against discrimination on the basis of gender identity in matters of housing, employment, credit, and education, but not in matters relative to public accommodations, such as those described above. And whereas today, legislation currently before the legislature would close this gap in state law and extend such protections to all people to prohibit discrimination in matters of public accommodations on the basis of gender identity, and guarantee equal access to public places regardless of gender identity. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts, affirms that it is the policy of the City of Northampton that no person shall unjustly discriminate against any person belonging to a protected category, including age, ancestry, or national origin, color, creed, family, or marital status, gender identity, genetic information, mental or physical ability, race, religion, sex, sexual orientation, socioeconomic status, or veteran status, relative to any essential public matter involving goods, services, or access that are generally available to all people, including education, employment, health care, housing, municipal services, and public accommodations. 2, affirms that it is the policy of the City of Northampton that no one shall refuse to grant admission to and full enjoyment of any public accommodation within the City of Northampton to a person consistent with that person's gender identity. And 3, supports the expeditious enactment of state legislation to extend protections against discrimination in matters of public accommodation on the basis of gender identity. And be it further resolved that the administrative assistant to the City Council shall cause a copy of this resolution to be sent to Governor Charles Baker, Senate President Stanley Rosenberg, Speaker of the House Robert DeLeo, State Representative Peter Cocott, as well as Northampton's federal representatives. I'll accept a motion.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Move on the floor. Councilor O'Donnell, you want to speak to your resolution?
Yeah, of course. I won't speak very long, actually, because I think this is something that there is broad consensus for in the city, and increasingly so in the state and beyond. I'll note that in 2011, this body approved a resolution in support of the last expansion of civil rights protections at the state level for gender identity, or on the basis of gender identity, in matters of housing and education, employment and credit. And that was in support of state legislation to do that. However, at the time, there was a carve-out that did not extend protections for people on the basis of gender identity in matters of public accommodations. And as the council president explained by reading the resolution, public accommodations is pretty much anywhere you go that's not in your house, any public place. So a restaurant or public transportation, a municipal building, a shopping mall, hotel, and so forth. Of the about 17 or so states that have non-discrimination laws in place to protect people on the basis of gender identity, and Massachusetts is one of them since 2011, I think we're the only one, or almost the only one, that has this carve-out with no protections for people in public accommodations. So the purpose of this resolution is to affirm that we do stand in support of that, and also to stand and at it with other cities and towns and our representatives to ask the legislature to act and the governor to sign on what the legislature passes, to act on legislation to close this very urgently needed loophole, or loophole that is we urgently need to close in our state civil rights law. Again, I think in the city of Northampton, it's something that we broadly agree on already, but it's very important, I think, to take a stand on this issue and show our support for this important civil rights legislation.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes. I'm glad to hear you, Councilor O'Donnell, talk about this resolution, because I think our city of Northampton is a great diversity, and I have not heard of any problems about public places, municipality buildings, and so forth. So I had concerns about that because of the language in here that our city is great, and we don't allow hate crimes, and we're very protective with anybody who comes to visit our city or who lives in this city. So I'm a little confused about why we're adding this on.
If I may.
Yes, please.
I think, Councilor, what you hit upon is actually a very important point, really about our democracy, if you'll indulge me in saying this. Our democracy and our freedoms associated with our democracy are not just about our government, not just about our campaigning, but they're really about our whole society. We want our freedoms to be extended in our day-to-day lives, and people need to be able to go about their lives without fear of harassment or discrimination. And the city of Northampton, I think, has shown by example how that is possible, how that's easy, and how it is desirable. So I look on this resolution not as a corrective measure for the city, but a way for us to lead by example and show the state that this is a good thing to do. So if that answers your question, because I'm not aware of problems, but then again, maybe I wouldn't experience the problems myself and I wouldn't know. I think statewide, it certainly is an issue of concern. Nationally, it's certainly an issue of concern. So I like the idea of the city leading the way on it.
I was very concerned about it because when we established the Human Rights Commission way back, it was unbelievable. And we saw it grow and grow and grow. And I just think the diversity is fantastic in this city. I think everybody is very protected in this city. We have a good police department, neighbors watch neighbors. And like I said, the hate crimes, I did have a problem with that about 4 years ago. And as a city councilor, I went right after that to make that individual realize you don't ever do this because we will not accept it. So I was very confused with this when there already was something in place, but you were making sure that the governor was going to understand that you wanted to include public places and so forth, correct?
That's right, Councilor. The legislation would fix a gap in state law. Currently, there are no protections in public accommodations in the basis of gender identity. So, for example, it would be lawful or not unlawful for a manager of a restaurant to come up to you if you perhaps had a different gender identity than most people and ask you to leave the restaurant. They could say, well, you know, you're making the customers feel uncomfortable. Please leave. That's discrimination. But in Massachusetts, there's no prohibition. State.
All right, but you're just strictly talking about our city, correct?
Well, I'm talking about support two things. First, our beliefs and our policy for our city, beliefs that I think have not changed, and that's why we're reaffirming a policy. And again, when the Human Rights Commission was established originally, I think this was articulated in different ways over time. We've had a charter change, of course, which has changed where the Human Rights Commission resides in law. It's now under the mayor's office. So it's appropriate to reassert that policy for the city. But the biggest use of this, I think, is to express an opinion on state legislation, because what Northampton gets right, I would like to see be extended to the rest of the Commonwealth.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Currently, the Senate has advanced their bill out of committee. Senator Stan Rosenberg has posted that on his site. The one pending in the legislature, still there, I believe. I think it's still in committee. You know, of course, some folks may realize that it was an ordinance, actually, in the city of Charlotte, North Carolina, that actually prompted the state to react with a bill antithetical to the whole concept of, as they described it, offering special privileges. They're not special privileges, they're universal privileges. But the fact is that the state is, and actually probably they're being reviewed as violating federal standards and law by restricting access to public accommodations for people who identify as transgender. And the fact is that I think, to Councilor O'Donnell's point, is that, you know, we as a community have affirmed over and over and over again our commitment and devotion to respecting the rights of all, and not just in word, but in deed. So this actually does, in some level, it's not an ordinance, but it is a resolution speaking about, it's reaffirming our commitment and resolve to do just that, to see that there's fairness and justice and equity, and not just lip service. And so, as you see, it serves two points. It is exhorting our reps and our state representatives and to move forward with the legislation that they're considering, and at the same time reasserting our stand on this. And I mean, it does not have the weight of law. So if the scenario that Councilor O'Donnell described did occur, we actually have no means to affect any action beyond public repudiation of it. But the fact is that there may hopefully soon be state legislation, and with some urging from us, that may actually may see the light. So, Councilor Carney.
Yes, I want to thank Councilor O'Donnell for presenting the resolution, and it should also be noted on a local level. The timing of this is also very good, given that Saturday is the 35th annual Pride March in the city of Northampton. And I just wanted to point out, I think that steps off, it should have been in the 1 minute announcements, but that Pride March steps off at noon on Saturday from Hampton Avenue and goes down to the fairground, where it will prove to be a great day of recognition for gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people all across the city. And people have been coming now to Northampton for nearly 35 years to note this special occasion in the city. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other comments, discussion? Okay, well, it's the resolution, but what's your preference on the vote? Would you like
roll call?
Roll call? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrill.
Yes.
Councilor Rodd.
Yes.
That passes in first reading and be revisited on the meeting of the 19th. There are no presentations, at least in this portion. We have the consent agenda, and this is to approve the minutes of April 21st, 2016 of the city
council. Move to approve.
I'll read the whole thing. Petition to discontinue a portion of Elm Street. This is to refer to the Committee on Public Works and Utilities and to the Department of Public Works and the Planning Board. Approve an application for permit for a supervised display of fireworks. This is an application received from the Northampton Family 4th Committee Incorporated of 40 Kai Street in Florence. The event date is June 25th, 2016 at Look Park. Also approve application for a secondhand dealer's license for Secmet LLC, doing business as Find, located at 42 Maple Street in Florence. And then also approve an application for a weekday and Sunday bowling license for Northampton Bowl located at 525 Pleasant Street. Also, to refer appointment to the Director of Public Works candidate Donna and Lascaglia. I should get that right. Lascaglia to the City Council Committee on City Services. And then also to refer appointments to the City Council Committee on City Services as follows. The Board of Health, a reappointment of Joanne Levin. Central Business Architecture Committee, this is an appointment of Bridget Goggins, of Melissa Fridlow. Community Preservation Committee is a reappointment of Brian Adams. Conservation Commission, reappointment of Mason Marin and appointment of Jason Perry. The Council on Aging, a reappointment of Robert Montague. Disability Commission, this is a reappointment of James Winston. Energy and Sustainability Commission, reappointment of Mary Biddle, Aidan Maynard, and Scott Silver. And the Planning Board to move Dan Felton from associate member to full member. So I'll accept the motion.
The minutes too, right?
Yep, that was the first thing I said. Yep. Okay.
Second.
Is that your second? Okay. All those in favor of approving the consent agenda, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay. Now we recess for finance and pass the gavel figuratively to Council Murphy, who will be presiding over finance.
Thank you. Ready for the roll?
Yep. Council Murphy.
I'm here.
Council Adams.
Here.
Council Kern.
Present.
Council LaBarge.
Present.
Excellent. So first item is to approve the minutes of April 26th. Do we have a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Second. Any corrections or additions or hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. So financial orders. As we near the end of the fiscal year, we have some budgetary things to deal with. The first is transfers. Order that the following FY 2016 budgetary transfers are hereby made. These are transfers into accounts. I'll mention the ones that indicate where the money's coming from. Into the City Council account, $1,130. Into information technology, $9,150. Into planning and sustainability, $621. Into parking maintenance, $6,541. Into the veteran services, $2,675. Into arts and culture, $6. A reserve for personnel, $1,754. The money is coming from parking maintenance, $6,541. Medical insurance, $15,336. Money to the City Council for travel, $2,100. Arts and culture for telephones, $540. And interest on municipal debt, it's $2,640 is coming from there. So a total of $24,517 from existing budgetary sources is being transferred from one place to another. Do we have a motion on this?
Make a motion.
Second?
Second.
Okay. The mayor, I guess. Any questions for the mayor or the finance director? Pretty straightforward. Anybody
now,
have any questions?
I do have a question.
For the mayor or Susan?
Either
probably
one.
Susan.
I just wanted to know this $2,100 for travel for City Council. What is that?
That was for counselors to attend the MMA.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Very good. Any other questions? Then all in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right. The next is upon the recommendation of the mayor. This is 16036, in order to authorize payment of a prior fiscal year bill for the Smith Vocational Agricultural School. Be it ordered, the council authorizes payment of a prior year bill from Smith Vocational and Agricultural School for $8,135.36 owed to the Durham School Services for Transportation. Do we have a motion on this one?
Make a motion.
Second.
Second.
Any questions on this one? No. Hearing none, then all in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please.
Aye.
Any opposed? Next is 16065, and this is an order to surplus property and authorize the mayor to transfer the property to the United States of America for inclusion in the Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge. This is upon the recommendation of Mayor David Narkowitz, Planning and Sustainability in the Conservation Commission. Order that whereas the Open Space and Recreation Multi-Use Plan 2011 to 2018 recommends preserving open space along the Connecticut River and the Connecticut River floodplain, and whereas on December 19, 2014, the City Council authorized the city to accept a deed for two parcels adjacent to the flood control dikes and the historic Mill River and transfer 39A71 to the U.S. for inclusion in the Conte National Fish and Wildlife Refuge. And whereas on August 13, 2015, the City Council authorized the city to transfer a surplus city parcel on Hockenham Road, ID 3918, to the United States of America for inclusion in the Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge. And whereas the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has expressed interest in a second parcel by the flood control dike, map 39A44, and a second parcel adjacent to the Hockenham Road parcel, map 39, parcel 55. And whereas the Conservation Commission, Agricultural Commission, and Department of Public Works have previously reviewed this request and support the transfer, now therefore it be ordered that the City Council find said parcels, map IDs 3955 and 39A44 surplus to the city uses and authorizes the mayor to transfer them to the United States of America for inclusion in the Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge. We got a motion?
Make a motion.
Second. Any questions on this one? Mr. Fyfe here. Mayor's here.
Recognize the mayor.
Oh, he's recognized.
I would ask Mr. Fyfe to come forward. He's been working on this. So
the two transactions, there was a parcel of land, the old Golash Farm, which was divided up when the interstate was built, and it was left with a little sliver, sliver to the south and sliver to the north, and they stopped paying taxes years ago because it wasn't worth anything. You all accept us to take a deed in lieu of foreclosure on the property. That's the first one. There were two pieces of that. The first one on the south side of the interstate, you authorized us to transfer to for the Fish and Wildlife Refuge. We didn't think they wanted it on the north side of the interstate, so we threw it in with the DPW sewage treatment plant parcel. DPW doesn't want it. We're basically just doing this to clean up our books. Turns out Conte's happy to take it. DPW is very happy to get rid of a liability from their books. So that's the second one. Then the other parcel, sort of similar story, even going back further. Hockman Road, some of you know, used to be called Hockman Ferry Road. None of us were around, even I wasn't around when there was a ferry across the river. And there's a piece of land which once held the ferry terminal or equipment. And because they messed up the ground, it was never usable for farming, big mounds of soil. A portion of that land is within the acquisition areas for the Conte Wildlife Refuge. So again, you guys surplus that a year ago to allow us to authorize it to Conte. The other side of the street is the part of the same terminal. It was beyond the acquisition boundary for Conte, so at the time they weren't willing to accept it. They've now expanded the acquisition boundaries, so they want it. So again, it gets us, it gets it off our books. It has no benefit for us, and they're interested in taking it.
Thank you, Wayne.
Counselor. While there is no benefit, is there a possible liability of loss of autonomy over or control over managing the land that's proximate to our sewage treatment facility?
It's the other side of the dike, and it's very wet out there. So it doesn't, it, you know, we walked, this was when Ned was still with us, we walked it and just, he couldn't figure out any possible use it would have for them for doing it. And he was in fact worried about, you know, it's been over years a homeless encampment. He didn't really want to be responsible for that. So it's really nothing that we could figure out at least.
And so this land now it belongs to the feds, basically. It's their responsibility to patrol, manage, maintain, and any assumed liability that goes with that. And since we weren't getting taxes on these properties anyway, it's not like there's a loss in any way.
That's exactly right. And we get, I think it's about $2, but we at least from the federal government, we get payment in lieu of taxes. It really doesn't come out to anything, but it's symbolic. At least you're getting.
Yes, as I understand, the feds sometimes pay the payment in lieu of taxes when it suits them, and sometimes they don't. It's, thank you.
Any other questions on this? And everyone in favor of a positive recommendation of finance, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The next one is 16066 to purchase land off Reservoir Road upon the recommendation of Mayor David J. Narquist, Planning and Sustainability and the Conservation Commission. Ordered that whereas the open space and recreation multi-use plan of 2011 to 2018 recommends protecting conservation land and unprotected gaps in the Sawmill Hills, and whereas the Talon Trust has agreed to sell 20 acres off Reservoir Road, map ID 10D36, surrounded by conservation land on three sides and water supply land on one side, for $150,000 to add to the Sawmill conservation area, and whereas the land provides trail links, protects city drinking water systems, and provides wildlife links between upland areas and wetland and water, and whereas the fund will be drawn from the CPA funds and current and past grants and donations, this order includes no new appropriation. Now, therefore, be it ordered that the Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire for conservation and passive recreation purposes, as provided under Section 8C of Chapter 40 of the General Laws, the Community Preservation Act, and Article 97 of the Amendments to the Massachusetts Constitution, any fee, easement, or conservation restriction as defined in Section 31, Chapter 184 of the General Laws, or any other interest in the above land and any immediately adjoining land, and that the City Council hereby accepts such conservation restriction, that the Conservation Commission and the Mayor are jointly authorized to grant conservation restrictions on any land so acquired. We have a motion.
Make a motion.
Second?
I'll second.
All right. Any questions on this one for Mr. Fiden or the Mayor or anyone?
Yes, sir. I actually had a question, if I may.
Sure.
Mr. Fiden? So, Mr. Fiden, this would apply to the other conservation purchases that are on the agenda. I'm just curious what the general policy is, when to pursue a fee purchase like these and when to pursue a purchase of a conservation restriction. Is there general policy on that in filling out the open space and recreation multi-use plan?
Yeah, generally, if we want land that includes public access and recreation or management rights, we want to own the land in fee, and that's the majority of parcels. The main time we're trying to get less than fees, so conservation restrictions or agricultural preservation restrictions, are on working lands. So somebody who's, I mean, certainly farmland. We generally don't want to own farmland. We'd rather a farmer own it. And also land that's actively managed for Christmas trees or forests or those kinds of things. Because we don't do as good a job at managing where you're actually getting a return out of the land. So okay. The majority of times is actually, and then actually the other thing is seller preference as well. So there are times we might want one versus the other, and a seller very much wants something, but usually it's those lines.
Okay, it's helpful, thank you.
Other questions? Hearing none, everyone in favor of a positive recommendation of finance?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Next one is 16067, upon the recommendation of Mayor David J. Narquist, Planning and Sustainability and the Conservation Commission. Order that, whereas Joseph Popularic, I guess. No one object to that.
Larchek
owns 14.429 acres on Rocky Hill Road, map ID 3790, in the Massachusetts Recreation Current Use Taxation Program 61B. So it's tax deferred. And whereas Chapter 61B gives the city the right of first refusal to purchase the land when it is removed from Chapter 61B, and whereas the property doesn't fit with the objectives of the Northampton Open Space Recreation and Multi-Use Plan, now therefore it be ordered that the mayor is authorized to waive, decline, and to assign the city's right of first refusal on the property. We have a motion on this one?
Motion.
Second.
Okay.
Mr. Fiden, we don't want this one.
Right. This property doesn't connect any conservation areas we own, and it likely never will. And so we're very careful about not taking every parcel out there. We want land that tells a story. This doesn't tell a story. It's on a road. It's best to be used for a house.
Mm-hmm. Now, is some of this developable?
It is, yes.
Okay. So we're going to let it sell on the – is there – at the moment, I'm sure they're asking because someone wants to buy it.
That's correct. Right. So we, in order to have us through this process, they have to give us a bona fide offer. Mm-hmm. They gave it to us, and it just doesn't. Right. Even at a low price, we wouldn't want it, and certainly not at the price that they're selling it for.
All right. Any other questions?
Just again, to specify, the right of first refusal means we'd have to pay that price.
Yeah, yeah. No, absolutely.
Just, yeah, so.
When anything comes out of 61, we have to either
thank
buy it or let it go.
Explaining that, Mayor.
Any other questions on this one? Hearing none, all in favor of a positive recommendation on this one, say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
This is also upon the recommendation of Mayor David J. Narquardt's Planning and Sustainability and the Conservation Commission. Order that, whereas the Open Space and Recreation Plan 2011 to 18 recommends preserving open space and valuable wetlands and upland habitat to connect the Mineral Hills Conservation Area with West Farms and filling gaps and missing teeth in the city's open space system and to provide multi-use trail opportunities. And whereas the owners of 55 acres located between Glendale and West Hampton Roads, the approved Kensington Estates subdivision have agreed to sell their property for $450,000. And whereas the city is working with the seller who may carve off some small amount of the land to lower the purchase price. And whereas the Massachusetts Land Grant provides up to 64% reimbursement for acquisition of certain conservation areas and is a reimbursement program which requires the city to demonstrate it has all the funds necessary to acquire the conservation properties prior to state reimbursement. Order that the Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire for conservation and passive recreation purposes as provided in Mass General Law 40 subsection 8C, any fee, easement, or conservation restriction as defined in Mass General Law Chapter 184 subsection 31, or any interest in the above land and any immediately adjoining land. The City Council hereby accepts such conservation restriction that the Conservation Commission is authorized to grant conservation restrictions on any land so acquired, and that the Conservation Commission is authorized to contract for and expend any federal, state, or other aid available for the project, including any grant from the Division of Conservation Services of the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs under the Land Self-Help Act, Mass General Law 132A, subsection 11. Further, that $450,000 is appropriated for such acquisition, and to meet this appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $450,000 under Mass General Law, Section 44, Subsection 7.3, and that the Conservation Commission is authorized to contract for any federal, state, or other aid available for the project, including any grant from the Division of Conservation Services or of the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs under the Land Self-Help Act, Chapter 132A, Subsection 11 of the General Laws, and further that any grants, donation, or sales shall be used to reimburse open space funds used for the purchase. We got a motion on this one?
Motion.
Second? Okay.
Let me start by just explaining things for anyone who's new, which is we are not going to use the borrowing authority. So we do this every year. It makes our much more competitive for these grant applications. And then a year later, Susan Wright comes before you to revoke the borrowing authority, but it lets us get funded. Right, right. So that's what we're doing now. So we guarantee we would not be borrowing this money. We once a year put together major acquisitions. We have a big, because it fits the cycle of state land acquisition grants. This year we actually have two. So this one and the one that's following it, so that's more than usual for us. And they're both really exciting opportunities. So this actually was an approved subdivision with 24 homes. They've been coming through the planning board about every 7 years for 30 years now to have this site approved as a preliminary subdivision. 3 years ago, they went to the next step and had approved as a definitive subdivision. So they thought they're gonna develop it. And they decided that the market's not right, and they've decided the market's never going to be right. That they've been waiting 30 years, and it has, you know, they've been sinking a lot of money into it, and so they're willing to sell the property. It's an important piece. Part of the reason the open space plan calls for a priority is it's above East Hampton's water drinking water supply. That's the whole reason we don't operate a landfill anymore, and so, you know, we like protecting their water supply, and we hope the towns north of us protect our water supply. It's sort of a gap, you can see on the map up there, but it's a gap between what we currently call the Ridge Conservation Area and West Farms Conservation Area. And so it's important from a wildlife standpoint, some great opportunities for multi-use trails through there. So it's a wonderful piece in that standpoint. While it's not the place for 24 homes, and one of the things the neighborhood particularly didn't like is the fact that it would have been a road built from Route 66 to Glendale Road, which would have created cut-through traffic. We are, you know, one of our goals besides protecting open space is making sure that in protecting open space, we're not artificially inflating the cost of land. So we want to create building lots enough to make sure that we're not doing that. Hence passing the Chapter 61 you voted on earlier. This lot, we think, is a good area for four homes right off Glendale Road. And so that's the part we're still negotiating going forward. That's why I said the price might drop. But we're looking at carving off four homes, one right on Glendale Road and one with a common driveway back from Glendale Road. The benefit for this setup is we get four lots, you know, get them in the tax rolls, get them in house lots, keep the price of land from going up, but we don't create any additional road that the city has to plow and maintain and send, you know, fire trucks down because there'd be a common driveway. So minimal cost to the city, but serves some of the housing needs for us.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes, I'm going to speak on this. This project here, as a city councilor, I did not agree to it, and many of our residents did not agree with that. I think the septic system was totally out of line. That one system was going to go ahead and feed and take care of 24 homes. There was a huge outcry. We had many, and I have to say, the owner of the property from, I think, New York was excellent. Well, it just was not the right area to have the 24 homes. If you're coming into Glendale Road, what he's actually talking about, on the right-hand side, further down past the second gate, a little bit further down past that second gate is where the septic system was going to go in back of somebody's yard. We have such wonderful wildlife out there that they would have been gone. And there's no question about it. Also, if you're coming up West Hampton Road and you go past Glendale Road, you come around the first bend, that's where the road was going to be. And there was an outcry about that from all the residents on Glendale Road and on West Hampton Road. Extremely dangerous. And having buses coming down there and picking up children, highly objected to the 24 houses, and so did a huge percentage over what, about 200 and something people who disagreed with that project. You and I had a site visit about, what, 3.5 weeks ago, and with residents, and they are so happy about this because you're not going to see 24 homes. They do not object to three or four more homes coming in there. We're using the open space. We're going to be able to connect to trails, and that's where the value is. And I think this is the right way to go.
Thank you.
Councilor Rowan. Okay. Just with regards to the carve-offs, or whatever you call it, is there any reason why the sellers wouldn't want to do that? Seems like it would make sense.
So what the sellers want is the agreed upon purchase price, and they want us to package the deal. They don't want to be in the land development business. Mm-hmm. So we're now beginning having discussions, both with Habitat for Humanity to see if they're interested and with private developers. So the idea would be if we can find buyers who want these four lots, mm-hmm. we would never take title. It wouldn't be a city sale. The seller doesn't care as long as we do a simultaneous closing. So we find four buyers or one buyer, they pay for that, seller is very, very happy.
Yeah.
But they just want to be done with it.
That's an interesting model. And if you couldn't find sellers, is there any mechanism to bring most of it into conservation, but somehow put the other parcels into some other category for future sale?
Yes, we could do that, and we have done that in the past. We did that on Garfield Avenue, for example, in Florence. Mm-hmm. It's a little more complicated. I can't use open space money to buy the land, so we would have to come either to borrow money or somehow get money to buy the land and then hold it.
Right.
We have done that a couple of times. Yeah. Generally, the way we try to do it is find the sellers before, but we have done it. Garfield's the most recent
it's
one.
Not ideal. But if you didn't find sellers, would that option still be open to
yes,
you?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you. Again, that just so it's clear, yeah. That would require me coming back to council. It's not what you're approving tonight, but that's.
No, I understand. No, I just think it's it seems to make sense, and it mixes both the goals of development and conservation. So, anyway, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And that's always a concern of mine when we take big chunks of lands off the tax rolls. And this, if we do it this way, and at least spin off four lots, that mitigates the amount of value that gets transferred to the other residential class members that, you know, I like the fact. And there's no sewer there, correct? So,
is it correct?
Yeah, so a couple of lots, it helps mitigate the taxes a little bit as they get developed and they contribute, so. Councilor Adams.
On that note, I wonder, do we keep track on a yearly basis of the land that comes off the tax rolls? Because every year we talk about the new growth, but, you know, we really should be considering how much taxable land we're losing. Because if you hear new growth alone, it doesn't take into consideration that there may be less than the net new growth than we're presented with. Do we keep track of that? And if so, can we have that report every year when we learn what new growth
sure,
is?
Sure, yes. We haven't done it every year, but basically when accounts are asked for, every couple of years we've done that assessment. And one of the things we've looked at is exactly what's the effect on the overall tax rate, you know, these properties being out. So that certainly is their due. Just so it's clear, by far, Look Park has much more. I mean, all these properties together don't have a huge taxable value. Look Park is the only one that really is significant. We can certainly run those numbers for you again.
Mm-hmm. This might not be your department, but I also mean other buildings, like, you know, like buildings from long ago, like the James House, or like okay. You know, the Arts building on Holly Street, all of which are obviously very important. But it is important to know what precisely the value is of those things when they come off these tax rolls.
Right. And I think the mayor and Susan did some of that when they were doing the pilot work. So I wasn't really involved with that other than looking at the data, but they've done some of those assessments there.
Mm-hmm. And because I too am concerned when we take developable land, because that certainly has a value to contribute. In this case, if we spin off four lots, that sort of mitigates everything, and where there isn't sewer there, that limits the development and developability in the first place. So as long as there's lot, we try and spin lots off of this to mitigate the amount of assessed value that gets transferred to the other residential property holders, I could be open. Any other questions on this one? Hearing none, all in favor of the positive recommendation of finance, please say aye.
Aye.
The next one is again upon the recommendation of the mayor, planning and sustainability, and the conservation commission authorize the purchase of 110 acres to add to the Brookwood Marsh conservation area. This is 16069. Order that, whereas the open space and recreation plan recommends preservation open space on Burt's Pit Road to preserve Northampton's only bog and rare species habitat and provide for multi-use trails to serve the area, and whereas the owners of 110 acres located on Burt's Pit Road, Stone Ridge Road, and Overlook Drive had agreed to sell their property for $500,000, and whereas the city is working with the seller, who may carve off some small amount of land to lower the purchase price, and whereas the Massachusetts land grant provides up to 64% reimbursement for acquisition of certain conservation areas and is a reimbursement program which requires the city to demonstrate it has all the funds necessary to acquire the conservation properties prior to state reimbursement. Order that the Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire for conservation or passive recreation purposes, as provided by Mass General Law 40, subsection 8C, any fee easement or conservation restriction as defined in Mass General Law 184, subsection 31, or any other interest in the above land and any immediately adjoining land, that the City Council hereby accepts such conservation restriction. The Conservation Commission is authorized to grant conservation restrictions on any land so acquired, and the Conservation Commission is authorized to contract for and expend any federal, state, or other aid available for the project, including any grant from the Division of Conservation Services of the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs under the Land Self-Help Act, Mass General Law, Chapter 132A, subsection 11. Further, that $500,000 is approved for such acquisition that to meet this appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the mayor, is authorized to borrow $500,000 under Mass General Law, Section 44, subsection 7.3, and that the Conservation Commission is authorized to contract for any federal, state, or other aid available for this project, including any grant from the Division of Conservation Services of the Executive Office of Environmental Affairs under the Land Self-Help Act, Chapter 132A, subsection 11 of the General Law, or that any grants, donation, or sales shall be used to reimburse the open space funds for the purchase. We got a motion on this one? Anyone?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Mr. Feith is on again.
So again, similar, we're not going to use this borrowing authority. It helps the grant application. Also similar in terms of doing limited development. different in a couple respects. It's a much more complex property. But the other thing is, in this case, the seller is also a developer. So the seller wants to keep some of the lots. So we're sort of breaking into two pieces. One is the seller is keeping a total of 6 building lots on the property, and those don't even show up on this map in the black. So the seller is keeping 2 lots on Stone Ridge Drive and up to 4 lots on Birch Spit Road, and I didn't highlight them as black because the seller is just going to keep them. In addition to those 6 lots the seller's keeping, it's our intention to carve off 2 lots on Overlook. Again, it's the one other place where it makes sense to do lots. So what that means is all the areas where there's existing frontage where no new roads can be would need to be developed would have lots along the edge. We would frankly share the, to the extent abutters never like new homes next to them, we'd share the burden, as it were, of new homes on all the abutters, so we're not just helping the lower income neighborhoods and hurting the, you know, treating everybody the same. But we'd be preserving the vast majority of the property. And I think importantly for everyone, we'd be preserving public access in from all 3 roads. So if you live in Overlook Drive, you live on Stone Ridge, or you live in Birch Pit, you could still walk into the property or bicycle into the property. So the vast majority of this is there.
I'm looking at this map. It appears there are 2 flag lot accesses, one on Florence Road and Birch Pit Road, too. Is that what's...
Those are sort of illusory. They exist, but they're underwater, so they're not developed. I mean, not quite underwater, but they're...
I can see the proximate. They're proximate to wetlands and water, so...
That's right, yeah. Right. They may be usable for people walking, certainly in the winter for walking, but they certainly could never be developed. So even if we weren't doing this, those finger... If you look at the map, you see Stone Ridge Drive is the one that has the cul-de-sac at the top. Everything east of Stone Ridge Drive... So as you look at it to the right, that couldn't have been developed anyway. That's mostly underwater or wet. Ecologically, it's some of the richest land in town. It's the only bog that we have in the entire city. So it's really important, but it wasn't going to be developed anyway. What would have been developed, if you were a developer, this property hasn't gone through the permitting process, but when we've done our own build-out assessment, we think there could have been 2 additional homes off Stone Ridge Drive that the developer's not doing, and we think there could have been about 38 or maybe a little less, 30, I think the exact number, 34, between Overlook and Birch Spit Road. That would have been, instead of being a dead-end street, you would have connected those things.
Right, so those lots that are represented there are paper lots, and there's nothing on the east side. Okay.
That's correct.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes. Wayne, there's a little history with this, which you know. Also, the owner... who has passed away, Doug Cole, was one of the best builders ever in Ward 6, between the quarry, also on Stone Ridge, all of the residents. We had several meetings with Doug Cole. Keith Davis and I worked very closely with Doug Cole, and we were able to get into the conservation area over by Keith Davis' house on Stone Ridge. It all began there. Of conserving conservation land. Doug was excellent. Overlook Drive was going to be, that was an outcry with that because of the amount of houses that were going to be placed at the end of that cul-de-sac area. Birch Spit Road, we're looking at 2 homes, correct?
No, Birch Spit Road might be 4 homes.
4 houses, right? And what was it going to be before?
Well, it would have been, I think, around 34, right? It's the right number.
Large. Very, very large.
Yeah, just to be clear, unlike Kensington that went all through the approvals, this never went through the approvals, so I'm doing a lot of speculation, but that's our best estimate.
Yes. Okay. And knowing the background of the family and so forth, I think this is the right move because we're not going to have this massive development, and we're looking at... the trails that we have in that area, the wildlife that we have in that area, it's gorgeous, and I would suggest some of you counselors go out and take a look at it. And I think this is the right move. And I know many of our residents are going to be very happy with this.
Thank you.
Questions, Councilor Scott?
The light blue, is that, are those wetlands? Even though
no, light blue is what's already protected, owned by the city in this case.
It's amazing.
Yes, Birch Spit. Well, say Brookwood Marsh is the term that we use for the whole area, but Birch Spit was actually where they mined peat for the state hospital and for other things. So Brookwood Marsh, the broader area.
Any other questions? This one I do have a hard time with, and I'm really familiar with this piece. This is developable land. There is water. There is sewer. In fact, that's why Mr. Cole secured it, was because Mr. Cole, when he, if he were alive, would be wanting to develop this piece. I know we just, well, he very much did want to develop this piece. And I met even Monday with the housing partnership people who are looking for places to put housing. And I know just this one, I think there are portions of it, as you say, from Stone Ridge over to behind Florence Road that absolutely isn't developable. It's a marsh. Absolutely can't do anything with that. But there is a possibility to develop a portion of this. I don't mind taking some of it. But here we are taking potentially developable land with water and sewer off the rolls. So I can't go along with taking the whole thing. I could get along with taking parts of it.
So one thing that's changed, that the reason this property never went forward, even when Doug Hull was alive, is, some of you may know, he assembled a lot of properties. It's a very complicated deal. He's assembled a lot of properties. The entire area from Overlook to the northerly end of Stone Ridge Drive is an area of special concern to the Natural Heritage Program because of rare species. They would not allow that to be a subdivision. And then the area of Stone Ridge Drive to the south had a vernal pool. That's what Keith Davis was involved with certifying. Right. So the original way that Doug was planning to maximize the property was, in essence, to connect all those pieces. The developable area is the area between Overlook and Burt's Pit. The rest of it really couldn't have been done there. So that's what it reduced it down. So that's why we worked. But for exactly the reasons you're saying, that's why we worked with the seller and said, let's figure out how many lots you're willing to keep. Let's figure out how many lots we carve out to do it. We made a lower offer to the seller showing how you get a road between Overlook Drive and Burt's Pit, and they weren't interested because, you know, they're looking at road costs of about $600 a foot, and they didn't think they could sell lots fast enough to pay the interest to the bank for doing it. So it could be developed, but it wasn't worth it. So their interest was also
today.
But so their interest is also lots that could be sold with frontage, but not the back lots that are out there. Yeah.
But economies change. So the undevelopable stuff I'm very willing to take, but not the potentially developable stuff. Counselor?
Yes. And one thing about Doug Cole, he could have made money on quite a bit of development, but he worked with the residents, also worked counselor of agreeing to CPA, just like we did up on Turkey Hill Road. He could have developed that, but no, he agreed to CPA funding instead of building and preserving conservation land. And that's why he was such an excellent, excellent builder to work with. But I think at one point, didn't you own property abutting around that area?
Yeah, we actually were required to leave the sewer, because we did Stone Ridge, we required to leave the sewer at the end of Stone Ridge available for Mr. Cole to run through this property.
Oh.
You know, so we were asked to leave it there with water to loop it through so that he could, in fact, develop it later. Yeah. So that's how I know the sewer is definitely there, because we put it there.
You put it there. Okay.
So I can't bite the whole thing, but I'm certainly the part by the marsh and the other undevelopable parts I have no trouble with. But just because the economy of scale doesn't work today, I don't want to take it all out of play, because it certainly has the potential to be developed at some point. But that's only one opinion. Any other questions in finance? And all in favor of a positive recommendation, finance, please.
Aye.
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 Okay. I'm going to be a no on this one, but I'm only one vote.
Thank you.
Nothing to worry about.
Next, upon the recommendation of the mayor, an order to appropriate $32,356.13 from the general fund free cash to the Northampton Public Schools for federal rate to support technologies and infrastructure. order that $32,356.31 be appropriated from the FY16 General Fund Undesignated Fund Balance to the Northampton Public Schools to pass through the school department for their federal E-rate funds for supporting technology infrastructure. Said funds will be deposited into, and then there's the account, which is going to make no sense to anybody. Do we have a motion?
Second.
Okay. Mayor's on.
So this is another one of those sort of pass-throughs where this where the school department receives some kind of a federal reimbursement, but it actually just flows to our general fund. It's not allowed to flow directly to the school. So what will happen is it will eventually flow to free cash at the end of the year. But what we want to do is basically just appropriate the money over to them. We do this, you may recall, frequently there's a program called the McKinney-Vento Homeless Program. Again, that's another one where we typically, they get a reimbursement from the federal government, but it comes directly to the city, and then we appropriate it over to them. The E-rate program is actually a program where it's through the FCC, and it's for educational institutions, and it's a program that they actually get reimbursement for technology, and actually, more specifically, in some cases, internet access. So that's what E-rate stands for. It's an it's a shorthand for a long FCC title, but it's basically they're getting an education rate on certain technology access. So that's what this is about. Okay.
Any other questions for that? Seeing none. In favor of a positive recommendation of finance, just say aye.
Aye.
Opposed. The next is also upon the recommendation of the mayor. This is the rescinding of a borrowing on a land grant. Order that $150,000 of borrowing authorized under the loan order approved August 13th, 2015 for the acquisition of land on East Hampton Road to expand open space land preservation near Arcadia Wildlife Sanctuary is to be rescinded as the city has received a land self-help act grant for the acquisition. We have a motion on this one.
Move approval.
Second. Okay. And we just talked about this earlier, that these happen every now and then. Does anybody have a question for the mayor on this one? Mm-hmm. Everyone seems happy. All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay. And then the last one, again upon the recommendation of the mayor. Order that $9,850 be appropriated from the FY16 General Fund Undesignated Fund Balance for technical assistance to the city to analyze existing broadband services in the city and a feasibility study to address the possibility of Northampton providing broadband and broadband-enabled services to private enterprise customers in the proximity of the existing municipal fiber network. We got a motion on this one?
Second.
Second. All right. Any questions for the mayor on this one? I'm assuming you have some on this one.
Okay, so councilors, this is actually a program that or a feasibility analysis that I've spoken with some of you about, and I know it's something that councilors have expressed interest in. You know, we just completed our first sort of 10-year contract with Comcast, and one of the big projects we undertook over the last 10 years was to construct our municipal fiber network, which runs all throughout the city. It connects 25 of our buildings, both municipal, school, and libraries. And so we've built this, basically this fiber network. In addition to that, we also because we're part of the Five College Network, we also have access to the Five College Network. We have four strands of fiber that we have access to, and as well as a connection to the One Federal Street in Springfield, which is one of the state's three data centers. So, and we primarily are utilizing the system, you know, internally. It's how we move data around the city. It's how we, these meetings are broadcast, and the data is sent around the city and back to, you know, NCTV studio and back at the high school. It's how our Munis system, it's how our public safety system. What we want to do is look into what many other communities are looking into, which is what are the potential options for our leveraging this infrastructure that we've built out into the community potentially. And so, you may be reading lately about several communities around us, in some cases because they had no access to broadband, in the case of Leverett, for example, which basically created their own broadband utility. But our neighbors to the north, Greenfield, have been working on a project to actually leverage their broadband services to, they're doing a test, a pilot, kind of a pilot program in their downtown area to actually become a broadband provider. And obviously to the south of us, Holyoke, to a smaller degree, because they already have an existing utility, Holyoke Gas and Electric. For years, they've actually offered on a smaller scale, they've offered internet access to people in the city of Holyoke through HG&E, but they're also looking at exploring this as well. We recently joined kind of a national network of cities around the country called Next Century Cities, which is kind of a growing group of cities, includes Boston, that have really been exploring this. And part of it's about trying to provide access to better and cheaper access, both for businesses, for economic development, but also just for residents and for educational purposes as well. So this is what we want to do, and Antonio Pagan, our IT director, this is something we've been talking about for a while, and what he wants to do is bring in somebody who's sort of an expert at these kinds of broadband systems, and really do an analysis of what we have here, what our existing infrastructure is, its proximity in terms of potential expansion beyond just the network, and then really give us some options, present some options that we could look at for the possibilities of exploring this, whether it's offering high-speed internet access to businesses, to downtown businesses, both here and up in Florence, whether there's a potential for residential, et cetera. And then actually, interestingly, because I just got done talking about E-rate, one of the other things, because there have been some reforms in FCC regulations, one of the other things we're going to take a look at is whether or not we could also become sort of the direct provider to our school system for its internet service through their E-rate program. So there's sort of a multi-pronged number of things we want to explore. And we really feel there's been a lot of discussion about it. I know there's a lot of interest in it, particularly when people see what's happening in other communities. I know Boston's also working on some initiatives. And so we want to kind of get out ahead of it, and we want to sort of do this first assessment of what we have and look at what the potential options are for us. So,
Counselor. I'm very excited about this. I mean, we've been, as you said, I've been talking about this for a while. Counselor O'Donnell and I were trying to discussing possibly aggregation with the surrounding communities, and the reason for this is providing broadband almost as a municipal utility allows, first of all, the Comcast or other providers actually throttle their service, and you pay for increments in speed and access, which is still pretty low compared to the rest of the world, which has much higher capacity for download and upload rates that we have to pay a premium for if we want to get it. If you have a business, you have to actually pay more, and you still don't get what's optimal. Leverett, on the other hand, I think it's a gig to 2 gigs up or down, mm-hmm. which ours, we're dealing in tiny increments below that and paying a premium for it. The other concern, of course, is that you touched on this, the digital divide. There are families and households that don't have broadband access that allows them basically the expanded world of the internet. And it, since education systems, and particularly universities, are trending towards those systems, and they're critical, we actually are leaving a whole segment of our population in a virtual internet desert because they can't afford the rates that are being asked for by the larger internet providers. It's also having greater authority over our own systems, our information systems, and these become critical now as power was you know, 100 years ago. It's electricity and service. And if you want to get a sense of that, you just go ask anyone in the Hill Towns who's still struggling to try and get any kind of high-speed or broadband in their communities, and the premium and the cost that that's doing to their communities. They cannot, their communities are not growing, they're losing population, opportunities for businesses to expand, job opportunities, education opportunities are denied them. We have a luxury here, but the fact is that we are basically held hostage by sanctioned monopolies. The utilities, we don't have, there's no competition implied. We negotiate with Comcast or Comcast, that's our choice. And we need an opportunity here to enhance our systems and our infrastructure. Chattanooga, Tennessee, for instance, is suddenly doing landmark business all based on the fact that they now have municipal broadband that they provide. There's a number of other Google communities that are doing remarkably well as a result. And
We applied at the first year of my administration to be a Google community, but we
lost the draw.
Yeah, I think.
And actually, we may have dodged a bullet in that respect at some level. Yeah. So we'll see, because as the technology evolves, I mean, we may have greater autonomy over what given the options that we have. So I'm excited with the fact that that you are signing up for this. I think this is a great idea, and I actually think that actually informs how we proceed as a revenue generating system, and also as an information access system for the community. This is one, I mean, we have one of our selling features for Northampton is such an appealing place to live. We can also appeal to businesses that, I mean, we're not going to become Silicon Valley.
No.
But the fact is, if you look at recent stories about Apple not paying any taxes, you would probably say, I don't want to be Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
The fact is, the jobs of the future, we're going to rely on a robust and fast internet infrastructure. And if we can provide that, then that gives us a leg up.
I know, and just before I take your question, just to quickly follow up on that, I know one of the things Mr. Pagan has talked about is, you know, trying to offer a 1 gig, you know, service. Because right now, most of that's not readily available except at a really high premium. And if we could offer a 1 gig, not only would it provide access, but it would also create competition in the marketplace in terms of the pricing structure that exists right now, which is pretty much there's limited to one provider. So so that is definitely, it has that potential as well to kind of open up the marketplace a little bit.
So I think he likes it, Councilor Klein.
I think this is a great direction to go in to think about Broughton Municipal Broadband. I'm just curious what we're going to be asked to vote on later after we get out of Finance Committee, the whole council, is fees for a consultant to tell us. I'd like to have more of an understanding of what we're looking to a consultant to do, because I think that there's clearly going to be support for this concept of municipal broadband, but what do we need to be told before we can actually do it? And why are we spending almost $10,000 for a consultant?
Yeah, I think the part of this is that most of these communities, and I've talked to Mayor Martin, you know, up in Greenfield, you know, how they got their program, and they are actually working with, they have a kind of a contract with a large firm that's actually putting that whole deal together for them, helping them form their municipal. They actually had to form a municipal light utility under Mass General Law. They had to, which was eventually what you would have to do potentially. And they had to take a vote. They had to have a vote of the legislature. They had to actually have a town-wide vote to create a utility. So it's a fairly specialized field. And in terms of the technology and in terms of the various models that are out there, it's not something that Mr. Pagan, our IT director, while he's a very seasoned IT professional, it's not something that he has that level of expertise in. So we really feel like it's important if we want to sort of get a good foundation of, A, what do we have here in terms of our system? And they're going to, you know, they're going to do some mapping of our system and look at where our INET is located, and then do some sort of wider mapping, and then look at various models that are allowed under Mass General Law and just other models around the country, and just give us some options that we could explore. And then there's also the smaller piece, which I mentioned before, which is the E-rate provider for our school system. So that's really what we're asking for. It's a fairly small, relatively small amount of money in terms of what potential there is. But it's just not something that, we have somebody in-house that's an expert on that.
It's partly because I hear that there are many other municipalities that have done this, and so it seems like perhaps there are already replicatable models. Yeah. And so I'm just wondering if we don't have the in-house expertise to essentially, take a replicatable model and make it happen here without us bringing in outside expertise. And that's why I was asking about that.
Yep. Okay.
Other questions, Councilor Bidwell?
I'm very excited about this, too. Pleased when we have a chance to hold council vote on it to support bringing in the outside expertise. As we in our community resources committee talk about challenges to downtown, opportunities to enhance the well-being of downtown and surrounding neighborhoods, the opportunity of providing enhanced broadband services, I think, is a huge part of what we can do to become more competitive.
Definitely.
In terms of economic development with other communities. So I'm very excited about this.
Again,
I just want to speak to Councilor Klein's concern that it's true. There actually are a number of communities, and they've all done something different. Some specifically tailored for their circumstances. Some have been solicited. Chattanooga, for instance, or the Google communities were actually solicited by these particular enterprises to become model cities and stuff. But at the same time, the developing technology and access to something that's, I think to speak to your point about reinventing the wheel hasn't actually been fully invented yet. I mean, I think that's at least, I think it's important for us to identify what our needs are and what infrastructure is going to work best for us going forward that wouldn't necessarily correlate with a number of other, some of the other model communities. And they're each unique, almost as unique as snowflakes and depending. So I would imagine that we'll be gleaning things from each community, businesses and, and successful ventures and ones that aren't. I mean, some of the problems is when communities do start to move towards municipal broadband, the internet providers tend to counteract either with suits or also by undercutting and offering higher speeds and cheaper rates until they exhaust or crush the city investment. Because there is those competing interests, and if they can undercut the city long enough to basically die them out, kill them out, then so I think those are all things you have to take into consideration. And I think this is a wise way to go. I would, because we only get one shot at this, and I'd really like to go in with the most amount of information we could possibly have.
And I just want to be I want to be clear. I'm announcing a feasibility study. I'm not announcing that we're
We're doing broadband. I understand
War with Comcast.
That's just my rhetoric.
Yeah, exactly.
The internet service providers who enjoy specific protections under state and federal law and FCC have taken considerable advantage of those circumstances.
Yeah, exactly.
And that landscape is changing, and Comcast is not going to give up their. I don't think they're particularly concerned about losing Northampton per se. They're just concerned about a domino effect that might take place over the rest of the country. So they want to nip it.
And there are also practical issues. In Holyoke, they own their own system. They own their poles and their wires. Same with Westfield. Here, half of ours are owned by Verizon. The other half are by National Grid. So, there's just different considerations. But so
we have leasing authority.
We do have some rights, which that's a whole other thing we'd be exploring in this as well. But again, I want to be clear that this is a real initial look at it.
And to that point, there are other communities, newer communities that actually have underground cable systems that are not reliant on poles, where there's different laws and different structures. Mm-hmm. And we have different challenges.
Some communities have done Wi-Fi, hives in different neighborhoods. These are the kinds of things they're going to look at. And again, it's particular to our, where our population centers, where our business centers are relative to our INET. And so that's what.
So before we get too far afield here, any other questions on this issue? And all in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? No. Good. And I think that brings us to the end of the finance agenda. So do we have a motion to adjourn finance?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Favor?
Aye.
You?
Okay, so come out of recess and go back into the regular meeting, and there we go. I will spare you the rereading of each one of these financial items, because Councilor Murphy did very ably. So item A, 16.060, this is the financial order regarding budgetary transfers between the various departments. First read.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carden.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
All right, that passes in first reading. Be taken up again at our May 19th meeting. Next item is 16.063, is financial order to authorize payment of a prior fiscal year bill for Smith Vocational and Agricultural School in the amount of $8,135.36. First
motion approved.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Yes.
Next up, item C, 16.066. This is the order to purchase land off of Reservoir Road. First reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carden?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. That passes in first reading. Will be revisited on our next meeting. Item 16.068, this is the order to purchase 55 plus or minus acres located between Glendale and West Hampton Roads. First reading.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shera?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Next up is the 16.069, so the order to authorize the purchase of 110 plus or minus acres to add to the Brookwood Marsh Conservation Area. First reading. Accept the motion?
So moved.
Second? Okay. Discussion? Councilor Murphy and Councilor Bidwell.
Yeah, I just still don't support this one only because it's taking developable land. A portion of it, yes. All of it, no. I think we're taking land that at some point in time may be developable off the tax rolls and shifting that burden. Don't mind buying conservation land that's conservation land, but some of this is developable with water and sewer. I'd like to see them trim it down and leave the developable land out.
Councilor Bidwell.
I'm going to be voting no on this particular measure because I share some of Councilor Murphy's reservations. I'm a land conservationist through and through, but I'm not convinced from what I've heard tonight that all of this land with water and sewer access should be made unavailable for development at a time when we need developable sites if they're located in the right places, and at a time when we should look for the appropriate opportunities to increase our tax base. So maybe that between now and second vote I'll learn more and come around, but right now I share those concerns. I'll be voting no.
Councilor Adams.
I agree with Councilor Murphy and Bidwell.
Any other comments to this issue? No? Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
No.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shera.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
No.
Councilor Bidwell.
No.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
This it passes in first reading and will be revisited again at our next meeting. And I would ask Mr. Fiden that he speak with the councilors who objected to help at least somehow address some of their concerns.
ask you a quick question? Did we miss 16.065?
Comes under orders. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Next up, F is 16.071. It's a financial order to appropriate $32,356.31 from the general fund free cash to the Northampton Public Schools for the federal E-rate to support technology infrastructure. First reading. Made and second. Discussion. Councilor O'Donnell.
Move to correct the spelling of the word through. And also, the title should be NPS. And also to ask that we always spell through the complicated long way.
For
this is spelled like a drive-through. I want to change THRU to add right. More letters.
In the order, so asking to amend or change, correct. It says Northampton Public Schools to pass THROUGH instead of THRU. For the school department for their federal E-rate.
Shame on the school department.
That's all.
By the way, it's going to be, Councilor Murphy was daunted by this, but it's going to, the funds to be deposited into W1245132 by 87014.
One of my favorites. It's
sorry. Any discussion amendments beyond that? That was a Scribner's. Oh, there's a second on that amendment?
Second.
All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Okay. Unopposed. Seems okay. To any other further discussion on the order as amended? Roll call, please.
Councilor
yes.
Councilor Sherrod.
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor
Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor
Murphy?
Yes.
And it passes in first reading. Next up, we have item 16.072. This is a financial order to rescind borrowing authority for the land off East Hampton Road, previously approved in August 2015. First reading.
Move approval. Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Sherrod?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Fine?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor
yes.
All right, passes in first reading. Item 16.076, this is to appropriate $9,850 from the general fund free cash for technical assistance to analyze broadband services. First reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this item?
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor
Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor
Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Fine?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
Sherrod?
Yes.
This is a first reading. Item 16.051, this is a financial order authorizing the payment of two previous year bills, should be used, whatever, from the DPW.
Second for you to say.
Yeah, second. The motion is made and seconded. Discussion? Councilor LaBarge made the motion, and
I forgot who seconded.
I seconded.
Councilor Bidwell seconds. Any further discussion?
Roll call, please. Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
Sherrod?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Passes in first reading. Second reading, sorry, thank you. That's passed. Item 16.052, this is the financial order regarding the gift donation of $10,000 for improvements to the City Council chambers. The second reading.
Move to approve.
Motion's made and seconded. Councilor O'Donnell, you had some concerns expressed before. I didn't know if you had an opportunity to speak with the solicitor about.
I think the comments the solicitor made at the time make sense to me. I have no doubt it's lawful. I'll probably vote the same way, though.
Okay. Yep. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Sherrod?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
That passes in second reading, and again, thank you for the.
Oh, I'm sorry. May I change my vote? I
meant to vote no.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. You announced that vote.
You decided you wanted a desk after all?
I, you know, the desk comment really made me. Sorry about that. Yeah. No, it's allowable under Robert's rules, as long as no one objects to it. So, yeah.
No, sorry.
You
may change your vote.
You
did express your intention.
I did. And then promptly, you know, didn't do that. Thank you very much.
Yes, and once again, thanks to for the generosity of the Exalted for improving our life. Item 16.053, this is a financial order to appropriate $46,798 from free cash to match funds for the Massachusetts Department of Conservation and Recreation and Urban Forestry. This is a second reading. Is there a motion?
Second.
Motion's made and second. Discussion.
Councilor
Dwight? Yes. Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBard?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shearer?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Green?
Yes.
Councilor Carr?
Yes.
All right, passes in second reading. Now we'll come to our orders, starting with A, 16.065. This is an order to surplus property and authorize the mayor to transfer the property to the United States of America for inclusion in the County Fish and Wildlife Refuge. First reading.
Motion. Approval.
Any further discussion on this item, Councilor Chair?
I should have thought of this when Mr. Fine was here, but maybe someone else can answer this. It was mentioned that sometimes there are encampments there, and does surplusing this to the feds impact our ability to go in with law enforcement or to do anything that we need to do in case there's some sort of issue?
That could still happen, although it would be their land, so they would have to coordinate if there was a trespassing issue or something like that. So that would just be more of a semantics thing. But if there was an issue and they we coordinated with them, then.
And what if there was an emergency?
Oh, we would still, I mean, if there's a public emergency, we have access. Yeah, okay. So that wouldn't be an issue. Okay. Yeah.
And any other action would have to be by their request, though?
Yes, right. Yeah. So because it would be
based on a complaint.
It would be a trespassing on private property. So,
any other questions? Discussion? Roll call, please. This first reading.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LeBard?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shearer?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes. So that passes in first reading. We'll be doing it again on the 19th. Item 16.067, this is an order authorizing the mayor to waive and decline the city's right of first refusal on property located on Rocky Hill Road. First reading.
Second.
Made and seconded. Discussion.
Councilor LeBard?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor
Shearer? Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor
Fox. Yes.
All right. That passes in first reading, and we will see it on the 19th. Now we're up to ordinances. This is 16.034. It's an ordinance pertaining to water resources. This comes with a positive recommendation from the Committee on Community Resources. 3 yes, 0 no, 1 absent. Positive recommendation from the Committee on Public Works and Utilities. 4 yes, 0 no. And a positive recommendation is amended from the Committee on Legislative Matters. 4 yes, 0 no. So, and the order is, here we go. This is the, in the year 2016, upon the recommendation of Councilor Ryan R. O'Donnell and Mayor David J. Narkowitz, this is an ordinance relative to public ownership of Northampton's water resources. And be it ordained by the City Council, the City of Northampton, and the City assembled as follows. Section 1, that subsection 325 of the Code of Ordinances be amended as follows. Strike Article 1 Use Regulations, add Article 1 Water Resources, and then subsection 325-1, strike the word reserved, and then add public ownership and control of water resources. The public water resources and infrastructure of the City of Northampton, including systems and facilities related to the supply, storage, treatment, and distribution of water, shall be owned or leased by the City of Northampton and controlled by the City of Northampton. And such sources and infrastructure shall not be sold, leased, or transferred into private ownership or control. And then it reorders in Section 2 that the article titled Water Use Regulations be moved directly before subsection 325-2, and that the article titles within Chapter 325 be renumbered to read Article 2, Water Use Regulations, Article 3, Water Emergencies and Restrictions, and Article 4, Drinking Water Protection. Accept a motion. Motion's made and seconded. Would the proponent like to speak to this?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. This is an ordinance with a very simple goal. It would make it unlawful for future city councilors or mayors to seek to privatize our water system and transfer it from public control to private control. And the reasons for this, I think, come from observing other communities across the country and also in the state who have had their own experiences in this kind of experiment. And I think I call it an experiment because, you know, in some cases this has been done out of desperation. In general, across the country, there are mounting maintenance needs for infrastructure of all kinds, including water infrastructure. And at the same time, there's less and less money to make the repairs and fix those, address those needs. So as a result, it has been the case that some communities have sought to solve their problem by just privatizing their system, selling it off to a company that claims that they can do the same for less money and maybe even do it better. I think that if you look at some of the places where this has happened, and I'll give you a quick overview of some examples, I think that Dream never pans out the way it's supposed to. There's a study that actually proponents and opponents of this idea both cite that makes it very clear that in general there's nothing magical and about the cost-saving potential of privatization. This is a study that comes from the Association for Public Policy Analysis and Management. That says when you look at all the places that do this, it's very rare that you'll see any cost savings. What you do see is a misalignment of incentives. Suddenly, the first priority is not the health and well-being and of the people who live in a community. It's not the water quality. It is profit, which makes perfect sense because unlike a city, a corporation is actually legally required to maximize their profits. The other thing that happens is you have a lack of public accountability. It's suddenly not the citizens and the residents who are accountable, to whom the people who run the utility are accountable. It's shareholders, perhaps, or the management of the company. And that's my primary concern. I'm not here to tell you that every single privatization example in history or plan that we could explore would be disastrous. That would be painting with too broad a brush. What I'm trying to say is in every single case where we could privatize something as fundamental as our water infrastructure, we would be eliminating democratic accountability and we would be misaligning incentives, which should be aligned such that the people of the city are served first. So I'd like to just give you a couple of examples of where this has gone wrong. A famous one is the city of Atlanta, which signed a 20-year lease with United Water, which was supposed to last from 1999 to 2019. The city terminated this agreement in 2003, so only 4 years into it, because of service that was called poor, unresponsiveness, a system that was fraught with breakdowns, a so-called epidemic of water main breaks, boil your water alerts, brown water from taps, and that kind of thing. Indianapolis went through a similar issue, and I'd also like to give you some examples from Massachusetts. The city of Lynn once had privatized water from a company called Veolia, which is one of the major companies that does this. Apparently, the company ceased use of a certain chemical, which was meant to, you know, treat the water, in an effort to save thousands and thousands of dollars. It essentially blanketed the city of Lynn in an unbearable stench for a time. And again, that's because of an effort by the company to save money. When you have these misaligned incentives, this is what you're inviting. The city of Gloucester recently had to pay a large fine from the state for its water and sewer treatment because the city officials, quote, failed to recognize the severity of a bacteria problem, and because of lax oversight by the city of its private contractor. If you're going to have a private contractor run your city system, suddenly you have to put in an enormous amount of oversight, which is pretty much equivalent to running it yourself. And if you don't, history shows you're going to have problems. I'll give you one final example. Again, I don't want to take too much time, but the city of Plymouth recently, February 2016, sued, again, Veolia, and the town's statement in regarding the lawsuit was this. The town believes that these breaks, major breaks in the water main, which actually cost the town $2 million, that these breaks are a result of Veolia's failure to operate properly operate and maintain the wastewater treatment collection system, including the force main. The town further believes that Veolia's failure constitutes negligence and material breach of its 1999 contract with the town. I would just submit to you that I'm not trying to reason by anecdote. Again, it's not inevitable that every single situation is going to be a nightmare, but there is something about setting this up so that the person who's running your utility has every incentive in the world to cut corners and cut costs. And it's always going to be at the expense of the consumer and the citizens of the city. You know, when people come and complain to us about the rate structure, and we have a debate about it, a heated debate about it, and have many, many months of discussion about it, at least they have the option to do that. You know, at least they have that option. So that democratic accountability is essential in terms of something so fundamental as water, which I believe everyone has a right to. And as a matter of principle, furthermore, something that is as basic as water should remain owned by the public. So that's my intro.
Councilor Klein.
Well, I'm thrilled to vote yes on this, and I want to thank you and the mayor for introducing it. I think that access to water is a basic human right, and it's also a public health issue. And basically, none of us can live without water, so it makes it a basic human right. And people, no matter what their income level, their race, their age, their gender, should have access to the water that they need. So it's our responsibility as a city and as a community to ensure that the quality of the water is safe, it's healthy, that it's good for all of our residents, and that we can keep it that way for future generations. Water is a public resource, and as such, it should be administered by municipalities that have the public's health and well-being in mind, as Councillor O'Donnell said, not by mega corporations and companies that are making a profit. When private companies, as Councillor O'Donnell said, when private companies control our water resources, profit motives take precedence over human rights. Another example to add to the list that we heard, Hoboken, New Jersey has a private water contract with a transnational company called Suez, and they failed so badly to provide upgrades and repairs that in March, within a matter of less than a week, there were two devastating water main breaks that caused large portions of the city not to have water for several days. So when water is privatized and corporations are responsible for our water, we see neglect and abuse that affects people in their everyday lives and accessing the water that they need to live. So this is why we need to make sure we're protecting our publicly managed water system here in Northampton. Just want to add a kind of political angle beyond that, in that the American Legislative Exchange Council, ALEC, the right-wing organization, is working hand-in-hand with major corporations to privatize basic human rights and services, the services that are basic human rights. They're working hand-in-hand with water companies like American Water, Veolia, which is actually a French company, Suez, and they're pushing agendas in state houses and municipalities that are trying to privatize things like education and water. And so we see these corporate lobbyists and organizations like ALEC attempting to create legislation at the state level and at the municipal level that is going to promote private industry over public management. And as Councilor O'Donnell also said, these companies and organizations like ALEC claim that there are economic incentives for privatizing a city's water supply. They say that it's more cost-effective to hire a company to manage its water, but it's largely been proven through research that that's untrue. Ultimately, it is more economical to provide for a municipality to provide water. But I just want to end by saying, more than that, the issue that undergirds this debate around privatizing versus municipal control of water is the importance of aligning our values, the provision of services and resources to our citizens, in a way that really can resonate with our ethics, our values. And we need our values to affirm that water is a basic human right, and it needs to be provided as such and not as a corporate commodity. So I am very strongly in favor of this this ordinance or order, and am looking forward to voting yes.
Councilor Bidwell.
When this ordinance came before both Community Resources Committee and Public Works Committee, I was pleased to be very supportive of it, as I will be here. I think it's a very forward-looking ordinance, and I'm impressed, Councilor O'Donnell's foresight in bringing this up. And I think it's very important that we be one of those communities. I hope there are many more that say our infrastructure is not available for privatization. So I think it's a very important measure.
Councilor Adams.
I don't support this ordinance. I raised some concerns in Public Works, and they were along the lines of, would this preclude us from certain opportunities? And I was wondering if proper procedures or safeguards are already in place. I've come to the conclusion that they are. I think we all agree that everyone should have water, and that's extremely important, and there is a right to it. And I was one of the people who voted to close the landfill to put the solar array above it, and I'm wondering if this could possibly be used to prevent that in the future. And that's one of my concerns, is when we do this, we might be preventing good opportunities in the future. Jonathan Goldman, who's a Northampton citizen and a member of the former Youth Commission, wrote a letter to the councilors or some of them. And I just want to point out a few of the what he wrote. Here he writes, and he states that he's put a great amount of research into this, and it seems like he has. First, not all private ownership models pose the problems often associated with non-public ownership. In fact, the most comprehensive studies, such as the one done in 2010 by the Association for Public Policy Analysis and Management, I think the one Councilor O'Donnell said, found that when comparing all successes and failures of private ownership, there was little to no harm from shifting ownership of water resources and sometimes significant benefit. Another point that Mr. Goldman made, passing an ordinance that affects the ability of future city councilors to take an action in dire situations would be irresponsible. For example, the 2002 150-page assessment by the National Research Council on the privatization of water in the United States gives several examples of when creating a ban like that proposed in this ordinance could be potentially harmful. He further writes, there are little to no substantial reasons for why Northampton should ban the leasing of the ownership and control of Northampton water resources. While private ownership can sometimes be detrimental, leasing has proven to be effective across the country and has few of any of the other problems of private ownership. This is outlined in the two previous studies, as well as by reports done by groups such as Food and Water Watch, who are largely against private water ownership. So they seem to be credible and not in support of private water generally. And finally, the last point that I'll mention of his is that the part of the ordinance conflicts with data seen across studies. For example, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development report on privatization of water that is full of case studies about the success of leases and how they can be used effectively. So I understand that the purpose of this is to be proactive and to have foresight, and I appreciate that. I find it reactive and short-sighted because it unnecessarily illegalizes future opportunities, And I believe the adequate safeguards are already in place because leases and sales are required by city council approval. So I mean, I guess that would take require, you know, that. But I think that's reasonable. Aside from why I oppose the policy, I also question the legality. Solicitor Seawald has ruled in several instances, and I'll give examples, that the city council cannot, by ordinance, require the executive branch to do anything or order it to not do anything. That's been his position sometimes. An example of that would be, I think it was 2 years ago when the mayor issued his executive policy on immigration protection, the trust policy. I drafted that in ordinance form and submitted it. And Solicitor Seawald told me it was illegal because we cannot tell the executive branch to, we can't mandate a certain policy of theirs. He told us earlier this year that we don't have the authority to regulate handicapped parking spaces at the senior center because it's near an executive building. That was almost completely made up, well, that one was completely made up of whole cloth. And none of these are with any legal precedent to back it up. So now this ordinance, which certainly tells the BPW or DPW, which is in charge of all these public water infrastructure systems and facilities, that it cannot sell, lease, or transfer them. So that's very clearly the legislature putting a limitation on the executive branch. So the solicitor needs to figure out what the charter means. And the solicitor needs to figure it out with respect to the separation of powers, because as I've just pointed out, he's been extremely inconsistent with this. He ignores his previous opinions when he finds it convenient, and he does that because he does that to give the mayor whatever he wants. And his interpretation of what is legal depends on who is asking the question. That's how the mayor's lawyer has interpreted the separation of powers. So I think at a minimum he needs to figure out what he thinks, give us some clear guidelines, because I mean, either we can or we can't order the executive branch to do things. We can or we can't. But sometimes we can and sometimes we can't, depending on who wants it done, is unacceptable. But I oppose the policy.
Councilor O'Donnell, you want to address the question, actually.
Thank you for your thoughtfulness on it, and I'd just like to respond to your points and Mr. Goldman's points. The first is the comparison between public models and private models, and the assertion that there is no difference between them, and that a certain report, the Association for Public Policy Analysis and Management, makes that case. The report makes no such thing. If you read the report, makes no such claim. The report is about the cost difference. The report says there is no difference. They do a regression analysis, and there is no general cost difference between public and private models. In fact, if you read that study, it also says, overall, private ownership offers more incentives for cost reduction, but these incentives can induce quality erosion. The other report that's cited from the National Research Council states, in part, I'm paraphrasing or cutting off part of the sentence, private operators being under contract or owning the utility are often farther removed from local politics. This has the advantage of less political intervention in matters of technical management, but can lead to less transparency and accountability. That is the issue. The technical challenges and maintenance challenges of running a water system, whether you are public or private, are comparable. I mean, the taking care of the granulated carbon system, making sure the chemicals are added to the water when they need to be, and so forth. That's comparable. What changes every time, necessarily, are the incentives, as Councillor Klein mentioned, and the accountability, as these very reports prove. Next, the question of whether this is going to tie our hands. This is an ordinance. Councilor Adams points out that we vote on a financial order if there were ever a privatization plan. That's true. If we were in an emergency situation, we would have a vote. The vote would be to modify or repeal this ordinance. There is no loss of public debate that would come from a ban like this, and there would be no nothing preventing us from taking action in the case of an emergency. Third, the question of leasing. Let me explain what this is about. There are two instances of the word lease in this ordinance. The first has to do with the city. It is to allow the city to lease something rather than own it outright for the purpose of operation of its infrastructure. For example, maybe we need to have a pipe or a pumping station on something on land that we don't own, but we can lease it. That increases our flexibility, not decreases it. The second has to do with control and making it unlawful to transfer public infrastructure and the control of it to another entity, whether it is done by lease or sale. You will almost never find an example of a complete outright sale of a water system to a company. What you will find is very, very long-term leases. For example, as I said earlier, the city of Atlanta leased theirs for 20 years, from 1999 to 2019. So since the essential issue is control, I am not sure that prohibiting a sale but allowing a lease makes any sense. Also, the form of transfer of ownership is irrelevant. Whether or not, for example, your house suits your needs, or you have a nice house or not so nice house, depends on the nature of the house. It doesn't matter whether you rent it or lease it or own it. So the lease versus sale, I think, is a red herring. I haven't heard any examples of how somehow a lease is better than a sale. And I would hasten to add that nothing in this ordinance should be construed to mean we can't retain consultants and outside help. We could, for example, retain a private water meter reading service if we wanted to, because that would not be equivalent to relinquishing control of our infrastructure or transferring the ownership. So I appreciate the thoughtfulness from Councilor Adams and Mr. Goldman. I don't think that once you look at the facts that those arguments stand up. And I just offer that rebuttal with all due respect. As far as legality, I'll put that aside. My belief is that it is legal. The solicitor has approved this. I would just note that, Council, you're saying that you don't believe in the solicitor's reasoning for why other ordinances are legal, but you agree with it in this case, which you may want to explain that. I'm not sure why that's relevant. But I'd just like to recap that this ordinance is legal. There is nothing tying our hands. The comparison between public and private models is real, and there is no evidence to suggest that one is just as good as the other. And the idea of leasing but not selling is not a substantive argument to oppose this ordinance. So.
That's right.
With respect to the legality, I think that the solicitor needs to be very clear about what the City Council can and can't do with respect to the separation of powers, and he's been inconsistent. But I don't want to vote no on this for that, because I would say, you know, I don't want to pick what I think is right, because I don't know which one is right. But it can only be one or the other. But my point about that is, I think he really needs to clarify his position on what isn't legal, because he's been very inconsistent. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you,
Councilor LaBarge.
I have some concerns here, especially with the landfill. Maybe the mayor, you could explain this to me, please. Because we're looking at putting solar in the landfill, and if we go ahead and do that, and they're going to go ahead and rent from us, right?
We're leasing the leasing the capped portion of the land, but that's not part of our water or sewer system.
But we have the Barnes Aquifer there, and Councilor Adams was also talking about the Glendale Road landfill, and that's what my concern is. That wouldn't affect us.
Would not affect that in any way. Yeah, does not affect that in any way. No, this was strictly related to our water system and our sewer system.
All right, because I'm hearing about privatizing or either leasing in that, and I know we're going to eventually do something there.
Actually very close to signing a contract on that. So the only other thing I would note is that I'm actually a co-sponsor of this, so I'm not actually being ordered to do anything. I'm actually joining in the creation of the policy.
Can I just address that?
Sure.
The policy orders the executive branch to do this thing. It doesn't have to do with Mayor David J. Narkowitz. It has to do with it orders the executive branch to do anything. This will last beyond the current mayor's administration. Adding the mayor as sponsor doesn't answer the question as to whether or not it's a legitimate It's an exception to all the other decisions of the solicitor previously.
Well, it seems to me that issues regarding the solicitor's opinions and their sources and their validity are not necessarily germane to this particular discussion at this point. I think you've had your fair say on this and that, but and I won't stop you, but I'm just saying that I want to stay closer to the issue, and I think the legality is an important feature. Historically, your opinion about the solicitor's allegiances and whatever may have some relevance to some degree, but I think you've made that point.
Okay. Legality is always an issue.
I didn't say otherwise.
We are creating laws. Legality is always a live issue.
I absolutely agree. Councilor O'Donnell. Well,
this ordinance is, there's nothing that prevents the City Council from setting broad policies about our water system. Someone tell me why it is, why it would be otherwise. Other than perhaps the solicitor, I mean, the solicitor has said that agrees with that. So I haven't heard anyone make any argument why this is unlawful. About this specific one, I heard about the senior centers. This ordinance, why is it unlawful?
Council Murphy hasn't had a chance to talk, and then I'll get back to you.
Oh, that was.
This is fascinating, but I'd like to move the question.
Well,
you can't right now.
Councilor Adams did have something to add.
As I stated in my original argument, this these facilities, the infrastructure, and the facilities related thereto and systems are under the control of the DPW. That control is, since it's under the DPW, it's part of the executive branch. By saying that we cannot sell, that this executive branch cannot sell or lease something, that is putting a limitation on what the executive branch can do. And in that way, it limits the executive branch. And in that way, it's telling the executive branch what it can or can't do. And that way, it's inconsistent with numerous other city solicitor decisions. I have them all, but I don't want to go. I have them all listed here because I keep track, because it's just, it shows how inconsistent it is and how it varies from who's making the request. But that's why it is, in that sense, it puts a limitation on what the executive branch can do. And it puts a limitation on what the executive branch can do by city ordinance. And he has stated very clearly, that he believes on certain occasions, depending on who's asking, that that violates the separation of powers.
Now, Councilor Murphy moved to call the question, which means, and I allowed that one other comment, but so it's, that ends.
I just have a really quick response. Sorry, was somebody
Councilor
else?
Councilor Murphy, would you be willing to withdraw your question call? There are some, Councilor Klein has not an opportunity to speak to this.
I'm sleeping. Magic words.
Right. Yeah, I mean. Yeah, I understand, but I think that.
I think the horse is dead.
Jesse.
I know, but the Councilor Klein has not had a chance to speak. No, that's fine. If you don't want to withdraw the question, Councilor Murphy has moved to call the question. Councilor.
Well, I mean, if Councilor Klein has something to say, a motion to call the question is a motion to call the previous question, which requires a second and a vote and a two-thirds majority.
And we have it. That's why I wanted to bring it back to that.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Is there a second on the call?
To call.
Call the question?
Question.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of calling the question, please say aye.
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 Any opposed?
No.
No.
Hands. Okay. All those in favor, say aye. Opposed? Well, that's the ayes have it. So, okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sherrod.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
No.
Councilor Bidwell.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Okay, that passes in first reading. We will have another opportunity, another bite at the apple on the 19th. Councilor LaBarge.
Yes. Of what I was hearing from Councilor Adam and between Councilor O'Donnell, I was wondering, because I have concerns of what I'm hearing from Councilor at Large Adams in regards to the legal parts of this, like the DPW and so forth like that. that we could get something in writing or have our city solicitor come in 2 weeks. Because I know for a fact of what I'm hearing tonight, I'm a little uncomfortable here. So to clear my mind, I'm asking you as our council president,
sure,
that we could air this out.
Well, you want an opinion from the city solicitor relative to the legality of this particular
case? Yes.
Okay. All right. All right. Next up.
Could you just have him compare it to any earlier decisions he's made?
I would like it just to, I think it's just a straightforward opinion relative to that. I think other issues that you have relative to that, I think you should take up with the solicitor or in some other formal format. Item 16.048, an ordinance to provide for the limited time parking on King Street by revising section 312-104, schedule 3 of the city code. This is second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and second. Any further discussion on this item?
This is an example of, I'm sorry, may.
Yes.
This is an example of a city council setting policy about public property. So, by the same logic, anyone who believes that should vote no on establishing this 15-minute space. Otherwise, as this is a great, great idea.
We should ask the solicitor for what if he thinks it's legal or not, because, you know, depending on who the sponsor is and who asks, you know, what day it is, you know, we'll get an answer.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
This is second reading.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Bidwell?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor
LeBlanc?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we have item 16.061. This is an ordinance to establish 2 1-hour parking spaces in Florence on Main Street. This is to refer to the Committee on Legislative Matters.
Move to refer.
Second.
Motion's made and second to refer. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. And then we have item 16.062, an ordinance to add a yield sign at Ventures Field Road. This is to refer to the Committee on Legislative Matters.
Move to refer.
Motion's made and second to refer. Discussion on the referral. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? No. As far as the update, I would want to add on to what Councilor Carney said. Pride March, 35th Pride March, stepped off Saturday down here in this parking lot, headed towards the fairground. It's 50% chance of rain, but no sunburns this year, but I look forward to seeing you all.
Jesse.
There are no other updates from me. Any other committee chairs have anything they want to add?
It's Pam.
No information requests, no new business. I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you all very much.